asynchronous transfer mode. Okay, so it is again a different architecture than we have studied earlier. So we have studied right now OSI layer model. We have studied something called a TCP/IP model, and you have seen that all the functions that you have seen, it is actually these things provide an abstraction. Okay, so it means it this OSI has different seven layers, and every seven layer has its functionality. Okay, so it is kind of abstraction that you are, the user are not aware of the complexity that what actually is going on. So it is just shielding you with the complexities of the layers. Okay, so it means in layer very tiny things are going on that are very complex to understand via naive user. Okay, so all the functionality that we have studied, suppose in this OSI layer in DLL, we have studied something called a framing, and then we have studied called something called a flow control and error control. Okay, so all these things we have studied, they are a part of this DLL layer. Okay, so keep in mind, it's all of this function within a layer that I'm discussing are very important in every architecture. Okay, so suppose flow control is very, very important. If I am talking about in TCP/IP, flow control will also be there. Okay, so it can happen that flow control is in a different layer, but it will always be there. In the similar way, error control, that one that I have made, that one error control when I have, this method is made. So this method is used in different architectures as well. Okay, so it is not that always. Always you when you are making a new architecture, you somehow has to use new things. Okay, so already the techniques are already present there. So only one or two, three things may be changed. If you've seen in this particular previously used architecture like Wi-Fi, they again using the same access control method like CSMACD. In Bluetooth, you may have already seen that it is also using TDMA, that is time to reach and multiplexing. So all the techniques that we have seen are same, but it just depends upon at what particular layer architecture is using what particular thing. Okay, so ATM, actually it is a totally different subject. Okay, so ATM, asynchronous transfer mode, like CN, ATM is a totally a different subject. So you can study it if you want in quite a bit of detail. So ATM, there is a different book for ATM networks. Okay, so we will not go into quite a bit of detail in what actually happens in ATM, but we just want to do a little bit of introduction to see how it is different from the traditional layers or traditional functions that is already used in CN. Okay, so keep in mind, ATM is itself a subject, so I will not go into a very big detail of ATM. So I'll just introduce you to the basics of it. So what are the frame architecture they are using, what is the header they are using, and why we need ATM. So if you're seeing here, most of the broadband architecture, broadband means your ISDN or your broadband architecture, this particular architecture is based on ATM. Okay, so ATM is one of the most effective and efficient technique when we are establishing connection in a broadband kind of a network. Okay, so just start with that. So driven by the integration of services and performance requirement of both telephony and data network. Okay, so actually how, on which principle this ATM is based on, I can call this particular one technique that you may have already seen, that is your packet switching. Okay, so ATM is nothing, just a blown up version of packet switching. Okay, so more specifically, virtual packet switching. Okay, so if you remember, I think virtual packet switching, that was it, because if there were two techniques, the packet switching is divided. Firstly, I think it was virtual circuit packet switching, I don't remember the name, I think. And another was a datagram switching. So packet switching is divided into two parts. The virtual part is somewhat like a connection based technique. Okay, so it is connection oriented technique. So what is the meaning of connection oriented here? Again, I'm going to tell you, connection oriented means that you have to establish a connection before sending some packets. Okay, so it is actually a blown up version of this particular packet switching variant. Okay, so we want the reliability of our circuit switching, and we want the division of packets. Okay, so that is why we use virtual packet switching. Okay, so in this, driven by the services and performance requirement of both telephony and data network. Okay, so if you remember, actually your internet, if you see, your internet is particularly based on packet switching. Okay, so it is actually a packet switching network, and your telephone networks are basically based on circuit switching. Earlier telephone networks. Now the telephone network is based on completely different thing. That is your ATM networks, and the ATM network follows this virtual packet switching. So it has something called that you can divide the data into packets, as well as it has something, a reliability that you have to establish a connection before you are do you want to send something. Okay, so if you remember virtual packet switching, what actually it was, that you divide the data into packets. Suppose I divide the data into packets here, and the first packet will contain the header. Okay, the first packet will contain the header, and every other packet will follow the first one. So it is just they are tying a rope to this packet, and this particular packet is tying the rope here. So this is how the virtual packet switching is done. Okay, so this is again, ATM is based on the basic principle of using this technology. Okay, so the technology that we have already studied, that is packet switching, and more specifically, I just don't remember the name, just wait a second. So the name is virtual circuit. Okay, so virtual circuit switching. Actually, it does not. The packet switching is divided into virtual circuit and datagram. Datagram switching. Okay, so these are the two parts, and we in ATM is particularly based on virtual circuits. Okay, so you will see ahead. Okay, so telephone network supports a single quality of service, and it is expensive to boot, so you already know it. And internet supports no quality of service, but it is flexible and cheap. So that is the advantage of internet service before. Okay, so why it is flexible? Because every other packet is following its own route, so I do not have to waste my resources on the internet, because every packet has a header. But that also make this particular technology very unreliable, because it is not very reliable, because it can happen that on the way your packet can get lost. Okay, so there are many problems related to that. Okay, so ATM networks were meant to support a range of service quality, that is both telephone and internet at once. Okay, so at a reasonable cost, intended to subsume both the telephone network and the internet. Okay, so that is why I'm talking about this particular technique, that is virtual circuit switching. Okay, so asynchronous transfer mode is another standard, that is international standard, that is developed by ITU-T. It is effective for something called call relay. Okay, so I'll tell you about call relay. They use something called ATM switches, and they use something called ATM cells. Okay, so ATM cells. Okay, so now what they do is they divide the part of communication or the packet into smaller size, fixed size. Okay, so what is very important, so it divides the packet into fixed size. They divide the communication into fixed size packets. Okay, so these particular packets are referred to as cells. Okay, so if I talk about cells in ATM, it actually means I'm dividing the packets into fixed size packet, and that packets, fixed size packets, are referred to as cell. Okay, so you can also, I think it will be written here. including multiple services such as data, video, voice, which is conveyed into a small fixed size packets called cells. Okay, cells are transmitted asynchronously and the network is connection oriented. So these cells are transmitted asynchronously and the network is connection oriented. Now, what is the meaning of connection oriented? That you have to establish the connection between the sender and receiver before you want to send any data. So that is why it's very reliable, as well as it is following the particular advantage of circuits or packet switching, because you divide the particular data or you divide the particular packet communication or a message into smaller fixed size packets. Okay, so this particular technology was come to develop broadband ISDN. Okay, so keep that in mind. So if you see nowadays, broadband is basically based on this ATM technology. Okay, so it was in early 90s, 70s and 80s, but it is considered as a evolution of packet switching. So what exactly is the evolution here? So it is talking about virtual circuits. Okay, so each cell, now the cell definition is defined here, is 53 bytes long, in which 5 bytes contain the header. Okay, so 5 byte contains the header and the remaining 48 byte contain your data, whatever you want to see. Okay, so it is your data or payload. Okay, so now making an ATM call requires first sending a message to set up the connection. So that is very important thing. Okay, so it is following the feature of circuit switching that it will send some message to establish a connection beforehand. Okay, another thing is it provides a high quality of service. It means that that message can be delivered from end to end. So it is also referred to as end to end quality of service. And whenever I use packet in this particular ATM network, I will not use the term packet here. Okay, so I will always use the term cell. Okay, so in this cell, this is, keep in mind, it is a fixed size cell. Keep that in mind. Okay, so here I think if you take out most of the book, you will find a payload here. So it actually means the data part. Okay, so just keep in mind the terms will be different from the usual terms that we have studied in CN. So there will be different terms here. Okay, so payload actually means your data, and packet here, it will be meant as cell. So what is a cell? It is a fixed size packet. Keep that in mind. Okay, so now another one is this is the ATM cell format here. If you're seeing here, this is your header, it's a 5 byte, and this is your payload, that is of 48 bytes. Okay, so this cell is fixed. So what happens in packet switching, you can divide a variable length packet as well. But in this particular network, or in this particular ATM network, the packet size or the cell size is always fixed. Okay, so again, if the packet size or the cell size is fixed, now you know the problem will be your internal fragmentation. So that also exists in that. So keep that in mind. Okay, so what is internal fragmentation? That you want to send, if you want to send something like 2 byte data, so it is 48 byte. So you will only use 2 bytes of data. The remaining will be empty. Okay, so because it is already there that this particular part, you have to do something called a padding here. Okay, so internal fragmentation exists here, but again, it's very I'll tell you about the another techniques, so this can be also avoided. Okay, so another one is this particular cell format. If you're seeing here, it is divided, it is of two types. Okay, so the first type is referred to as your UNI header, and the another header is referred to as your NNI header. Okay, so if you're seeing here, only the difference between here is the GFC. Okay, so GFC is your generic flow control. Okay, so in UNI header, generic flow control means flow control mechanism is defined here. So again, the flow control mechanism, if you remember, that we have already studied all the protocols like SR protocol, another protocol, go back and stop and wait. So in this UNI header, the GFC, generic flow control, is defined here. But in this particular NNI header, there is no generic flow control. Okay, other than that, I think everything is same. The VPI switches are two here, I think. Okay, I think there is a little bit. Yeah, the VPI switches are two here and VCI is one. Okay, so everything seems very similar, Only the difference is in UNI header, you have a generic flow control. Okay. So the UNI header part, that what header I'm talking about, this if you're seeing the 5-byte part, okay. So the 5-byte part here contains the GFC. The 5-byte part here does not contain the GFC. So again, it is, if you know, this is actually 53-byte long cell. Okay. So again, it's a every particular communication have to be in that format. Okay. So now UNI header is mostly used in private networks of ATM. Means that ATM will autonomously, if there is ATM network, this is the ATM network, there will be something called ATM endpoints or ATM switches. Okay. So suppose this is an ATM endpoint and there is an ATM switch and there is an ATM endpoint. Okay. So this now I can call this particular network as a ATM network. Okay. So it is a complete autonomous network. What happens is that this is I can call this is a ATM private network. Okay. So what happens in that is if you want to establish a communication between these ATM endpoints, I will use this particular UNI header. Okay. So which is used in within private networks of ATM for communication between ATM endpoints and ATM switches. Okay. So when I want to communicate between ATM switches and endpoints, we always use a UNI header. That is why the generic flow control is defined here. So it is includes the generic flow control field. The NNI header, it's also used for the communication between ATM switches. So there is no endpoint here, keep in mind, and it does not include generic flow control. So there, the flow control mechanism is not defined here. So the flow control is based on this virtual path identifier. Sorry, it is based on this virtual path identifier, which I think occupy 12-13 bits. Okay, so I think instead it includes a virtual path identifier which occupies the first 12 bits. So VPN, here the flow control mechanism is completely done by VPI. Okay, so that is your virtual path identifier. So what actually is it? So virtual path identifier and VCI, this is I think virtual connection and identifier, so they are both combined to find out what is the next particular point in which I want to send data. Okay, so I'll tell you about it. Okay, so every term is explained, every field is explained here. So it is your flow control provides local functions such as identifying multiple station that share a single ATM share. So this field typically not used, and it is set to a default value of zero. So generic flow control is typically not used because it is, the flow control mechanism is based on VPI and VCI. So that is why it we have given the provision of flow control, but actually we implement, so the it is set as default as zero. It means that it is not used right now. So we only use the flow control with the help of VPI and VCI. So what is VPI here? Virtual path identifier. So in conjunction, so it combination with the VCI, it identifies the next destination of the cell. Okay. So that is what we want to say. So flow control, this VPI, what it do? So if you want to send, this is your packet, and this packet will have to go towards this path. So this VPI virtual path identifier will tell you to follow this path. Okay, so it is used in conjunction with VCI. Keep that in mind. This is by virtual channel identifier. Okay, so it is also used with VPI to identify the next destination of the cell as it passes through a series of ATM switches on the way to its destination. Okay, so keep in mind that the flow control mechanism is a little bit different here than the earlier flow control mechanism that we have used earlier. Okay, so here the flow control is based on VPI, that is virtual path identifier, and second is virtual channel identifier. Okay, another thing is your payload. So payload type, also it is, I think, user data. It also contains some other functions also. Okay, so if the cell contains user data, the bit is set to zero, so it will always, the bit will be set to zero. So this is payload type. Okay, so it means it actually, the payload type, why here it is written as payload type here. So sometime if you do not want to send the data, okay, so it would, if you want to send a different type of data like control data and other like you want to say that there is a very much traffic here, you do not send your packets here because there is so much traffic here, because there is no generic flow control. So what actually is flow control? So if you are transferring data within two networks, so flow control is actually that mechanism that when you are sending some data to it, so this particular receiver has a sufficient amount of time to process that data. Okay, so if you are directly sending it again and again and again, so what is the use of it? Because if the receiver machine buffer is full, whatever you are sending will be lost here. So this payload is serving two purposes here. If you are sending the data, that is actually fine. So if the bit is set to zero, you can send the data. But it also controls, if it contains control data. Okay, so it is set to one. So one for control data, I'll tell you about it. And the second bit indicates concession. Okay, so the flow control is actually done with the help of this payload type. So if there is a concession, it will set that if the set that bit to one. So if it is there is no concession, it will set that bit to zero. Okay, so it means that if there is no traffic, you can send your data at a normal rate. But if there is a concession, it means you have to send your data accordingly. Okay, so and the third bit indicates whether the cell is in the last in a series of cell that represent a single AL5 frame. Okay, so this particular bit tell you that the last bit indicate that if your data is divided into three particular cell fragments, so this is your first packet, second packet, and third packet. If this is the last, this is your last packet. So in this particular term, your last bit, that the third bit of this will be set to one, saying that I am the last packet here. So that is why it is used. Okay. Another is your cell loss priority. Now, the loss is also calculated here because in the flow control, you already know if there is no acknowledgement, the packet is termed as lost, but we are not implementing flow control here. That is why here it is written as cell loss priority. Okay, so indicate whether a cell should be discarded if it encounter extreme concession. So that is the reason. Okay, so if it is, if in the payload, it is termed as one, so CLP header will also come into play. Okay, so if there is an extreme concession, so that the cell will be discarded here. Okay, so as it moves through the network, if CLP bit is equal to one, the cell should be discarded in preference to cell with the CLP bit equal to zero. Okay, so it means the CLP bit, if the CLP bit is one, it means that there was extreme concession, so the packet might be corrupted. So that is why if you want to discard something, you discard those particular packets that has a CLP bit equal to one here, because the one bit indicates that this packet has come from extreme congestion. Okay, another is your error control. Okay, so actually there is no error control method here. You are saying now CRC, no checksum. So again, we have to do some error control. So for that, there is HEC, that is header error control. So in this particular range, we use checksum. Okay, so checksum, again, the technique we already studied, so the checksum is similar here. Okay, now the working of ATM, it is again based on the same thing, that is virtual path identifiers and virtual channel connection. So you can read about it, there is nothing to it, so only two paras are here, so you can read about it. Another one is your, what is the difference between the ATM and your data network, that is your internet. Okay, so again, ATM is based on virtual circuit. Okay, so I already told you in the starting that ATM is actually a virtual circuit based technique. The path is reserved before the transmission, but internet, we do not reserve any path, we just send the packet with the address to it. Okay, so while IP is a connectionless, okay, so connectionless, we do not reserve the path before sending anything, and it's an end-to-end resource reservation, not possible. So in internet, we cannot reserve any path. Okay, so it is this RSVP is, it's a new signaling protocol. It is it's also used in internet, that says that I want to send some signal, so just reserve some path for me. But it is actually not very useful in this context. Okay, so it is used to imitate the virtual circuit thing, but actually it is not very useful. There are not many problems with it. Okay, so RSVP is a way to implement virtual circuit, but still it is very new and we do not actually use it. Okay, so ATM cell, it is a fixed size cell. Size trade-off is between the voice and data, while IP packets are of variable size. So that is also one difference, that ATM cells are always fixed. Okay, so they have choose this particular they have choose this particular number here, that is 53 bytes, because they have observed, they choose this 53 number, the 53 byte header, because they have seen, they have researched that how many average size packet that we transfer. So that is why this fixed this particular number to 53 byte. But in actually in IP packets, the size is variable, you already know that, okay? So it addressing, IP addressing, we will, I'll tell you about when I come to it, because it has class A, class B, class C, and class D, class E networks. That is totally differently. It is based on telephone networking. If you STD code, ISD code, that code. And in this particular case, it only used global NSAP addressing for signaling. Okay. So it is a bit different, 20 byte global NSAP addresses. Okay. So they will be unique in all of the universe. Okay. These are your ATM layers. So actually the main layers are your ATM adaptation layer, ATM layer, and physical layer. So physical layer, we already know it will be dealing with zeros and ones, and another like your encoding techniques. Either you can send, want to send your data in the form of Manchester encoding and other techniques, that will be in the part of physical layer. So the first and the foremost layer is your ATM adaptation layer. Okay. So it is meant for isolating higher layer protocols from details of ATM processes and prepares for conversion of user data into cells. Okay. So this is, if you're seeing here, it is very close to the application layer. I don't think there is an application layer here. So actually your data, whatever user want to send, if you user want to send to data, this particular message will be divided into fixed length cells. Okay. So this is the responsibility of adaptation layer. Okay. So it will take the message and divide the message into fixed length cells. Okay. So again, you know it, 40 byte of cell data and 5 byte of your header. So ATL protocol expects transmission from upper layer services, help them in mapping applications like voice data. So all the thing you are seeing here, control plane, user plane, this is your user plane actually. So this is your user plane. From this particular part, user will interact, okay? So upper layers and upper layers. So what this ATM adaptation loop will, it can interact with the upper layers, and all the protocols here that will be present here in the layer management or the plane management part will help this ATM adaptation layer to divide the data into particular cells. Okay. So another layer is physical layer. You already know physical layer. So it is just dependent upon the bit stream. So main function will be converts a cell into a bit stream. So it will be ones and zeros and ones. It control the transmission and receipt of the bits in the physical media. It can track the cell boundaries, and it can look for packaging a cell into appropriate types of frame. So everything is similar. Its function is almost similar that we have studied in our OSI layer, physical layer. Okay. So ATM layer is the, I think, the last layer here. Okay. So all the functions that we have studied in layer, every particular function that you can think about is done in ATM layer. Okay. So what do I talk about this? So it handles transmission, it handles switching, it handles congestion control, it handles cell header processing, sequential delivery, and many other things. Okay. So all the things that we have studied in OSI layer, because the flow control is already managed by VPI and VCI. So again, it is VPI and VCI is also done by this ATM layer. So everything that we have studied is actually a part of the ATM layer. So that is how the architecture is arranged. Okay. So ATM layer in this particular architecture has most of the responsibility. Okay. So, and is responsible for sharing the virtual circuit over the physical link known as cell multiplexing and passing the cell through ATM cells, also known as cell relay. Okay. So it also make use of the information that is VPI and VCI in the cell header. Okay. So every main part, okay, so that every software related part is done by this ATM layer. So that is why it is referred to as an ATM layer. So ATM layers means it will handle almost all the things that is related to the software part. Okay, so I can call that all the things related to flow control, error control, congestion control, header, everything is done in this particular layer. Okay. So there are some applications, so you can read about it. Okay, so with this, your ATM layer is finished. Okay, so again, if you want more detail, actually it is a completely different subject. If you want more detail, you can refer to a book. Okay, I don't think that you may need to go beyond that. Okay, so if you still want more information regarding it, you can refer to Ferozan. Okay, so there will be more information of ATMs, but ATM is totally a different subject. I just provided you the introduction of ATM. Okay, so you can seize the application. The main application of ATM is used in broadbands. One thing you keep in mind, another thing is that it's a blown up version of your virtual circuits. Okay, so that is the main thing, main takeaway from this network. Okay, so if you have done some questions here, so I have posted this question files. So if you have done it, it's well. So I've included more questions also. So these are the answer here. So this particular question, I think that you may not be able to revise many concepts. So because I have discussed many concepts with the numerical parts here. So this particular question is based on actually packet switching. Okay. So packet switching question, I don't think you have done. So I have only shown you that if you divide the message into packets, it should be ideal. Okay, so if you are dividing the packets if you're dividing the message into many packets, so the communication is that it will be equal to the communication that you are actually doing in a serial thing. Okay, so this is a very good question that you will find in packet switching. Okay, so if you just I copy and paste this, it's a very good question. Okay, so I'll show you how to solve this one. Okay, so just see this question, what actually it is saying. So okay, keep in mind, when the question is very large, it looks very intimidating. These questions are one of the easiest question. Okay, so if there are so many things written, these question are the least or the smallest, or what you say, are the simplest question that you will find. Okay, so always if you're preparing for GATE, or if you are preparing for any CCNA exam, if the question is very lengthy, that question is very easy. Okay, so you just have to extract out the terms that it is using. If a question is very lengthy, keep in mind it will always be very easy, because most of the students, just by looking at the lengthy question, they just leave it and move on to the next question. So that is also one strategy that any other testing agency used to just make this question a little bit complicating, that it has to be, but actually the question was very, very easy. Okay, so now I think this question is from GATE. Okay, so I think it's GATE 2015 or 16 question, I don't remember it, but it's a very good question that is based on a packet switching. Okay, so it will test your concepts on the packet switching. So if you remember, packet switching is when you transfer the data parallelly. Okay, so I'll read the question. Okay, so since it is a network that uses switch, okay, so there will be a switch. Every packet goes through two links. Okay, so it is saying two links. First link is from source. Suppose this is your source. From source to a switch, from source, remember, term this is a switch, and other from switch to destination. Okay, so this is your switch, from switch to destination. So this is first line. Okay, that's well and fine. Another thing is, since there are 10,000 packets, 10,000 bits. Okay, so it means total data. So I can call it total data is 10,000 bit. The packet size is 5. Okay, so packet size is 5,000. So it is already given here. Two packets are sent. Okay, so it means because the packet size is 5,000 bytes, so you have to send two packets. That is already clear, because the packet size is 5,000. Okay, so there is no header or anything given, so I don't need to bother about that part. Okay, so because they are directly giving you that one packet size is 500, so it means that header and everything information will be included in, if they are not mentioning anything about the header. Okay, another thing is, transmission time for each packet is So TT is also given here. TT is 5000 divided by 10 raised to power 7 microseconds. So microsecond is this one. Okay. So microsecond was 10 raised to power minus 6, I think. Okay. So if you keep in mind this. Milli was minus 3, micro was minus 6, nano was minus 9. Okay, so actually it is TT, you already know it is length of the packet over the bandwidth. Length of the bandwidth, yeah. Okay, so I think this particular 10 raised to power 7 should be the bandwidth. Okay, so check it. Two hosts are connected via packet switch. So they have termed now this solution as a packet switch with 10 raised to power 7 bits per second. Okay, so it means they are the bandwidth is already given here. So bandwidth was 10 raised to power 7 bits per second. So again, the TT will be calculated as length by the bandwidth. So length, we already know length of the packet is 5000 byte, and the bandwidth, it is already given in the question. So they have already given it. Actually, they you can also derive it out from here that this is the length of the packet and this is the bandwidth, but they are already given it. So you can go like that also. Okay, so now each link has a propagation delay of 20 microsecond. Okay, so it means 20 microsecond from here and 20 microsecond from here. So microsecond they are talking about in this term. Each link has 20 microsecond. The switch begins forwarding a packet 35 microseconds after it receives the same. Okay, so it means there is a delay here. So I'll say there is a delay of plus 35. So just remember it, the switch has a delay. So it will process it for 35 seconds. After it, it will perform the transmission and propagation. Okay. So one thing I know from it here. Okay. So after it receives the same. If 10,000 bits of data are to be transmitted between two hosts using a packet size 5,000 bit, the time elapsed between the transmission of the first bit and the reception of the last bit. Okay. So they are just talking about what will be the total time. If I start from this particular sender, the source to the destination. Okay, so they are talking about the maximum time. Okay, so first time that the TP is already given here. So TP is 20 microsecond. Now I need the transmission time. Okay, so what is the transmission time here? It is 5000 into 10 raised to power minus 7. Okay, so I'll take it at a minus 7. So I can take it in the microsecond term. Okay, so it will be 500 into 10 raised to power minus 6. So it can be termed as 500 microsecond. So it means that the transmission time will be 500 microsecond here, then 20 microsecond here, then 35 microsecond it will wait for it, and again 500 microsecond to transmit it, and it will receive the destination. Okay, so this is how you can get to it. Okay, so now it is very important. So because it is a packet switching, it is not a circuit switching. So it means that when your packet, when you send the packet, when you put the packet onto the link, now it will start the source will start with the second packet. Okay, so I'll just focus on the first packet right now. So suppose at time zero, so I'll list it. It is very easy. It is very difficult to understand. So I'll write the timing here. Okay. So at time zero, I'll say packet start from source. Just understand it. If you know the concept of packet switching, it is very, very simple. Okay. So keep in mind there is 35 microsecond delay with the switch that is already given in the question. Okay. Now, what I'll do, now I will start the transmitting process. So at T equal to 500. So it means that P1, so I'm naming the packet as P1, packet 1 is on the link. Okay, so because it only requires 500 microseconds, so by the end of the 500 packets, 500 microsecond, the packet P1 is on the link. That will always be available on the link. Okay, so now what will happen after that? At 20 seconds, so transmission time is 20 seconds here. So transmission time is 20 seconds. So this at 520 microsecond, P1 is available at the switch. Okay, so it is available at the switch. So we already know this. Okay. So from the switch, there is a additional delay of 35. Okay, so there is an additional delay of 35 here. So just add 35 to this. 520 to 35, that will be 555. Okay, so I think, yeah. So at 555, it is still on the, so P1 is still on this because the processing is going on. So after that, again, you have to add 500 to this particular packet. That will be 551055. Okay, so at time 1055, your P1 is available on the link. Okay, so I'll say it is on the link. Okay, so because it will also require 35 plus 500 microseconds to put this packet under the link. Now again, for again add 20 here. So because the propagation time is 20, so add 20 to it. So it means at t equal to 1075, your P1 is at the station. Okay, so at the destination. So that is what we want. Okay, so now understand this particular question. So this is only for packet P1. There will be two packets. Okay. So now understand this, because it is a packet switching. Okay, so that is very important to understand. So most of the students will make a mistake here if they do not know the concept of packet switching. They will just whatever they got, what they got is like 1057. They will add 1075 again, because they will think that for the first packet, if it is 1075, the second packet, it will also be 1075. So that is very, very wrong. Okay, so if you do not know the concept, because everything goes in parallel. Okay, so now with this written here, now at time zero, at time 500, when your packet is on the link, this particular source is free now. Okay, so now I'm talking about packet second. This is about packet one, and this is about packet second. Okay, so at 500, now at time 500, your packet P2 will start on the link. Okay, so I will start putting this packet onto the link. Okay, so packet start from source for packet P2. Okay, so that you have to keep in mind. I'm talking about P2 here. This is all about P1. Okay, so it means at 500 you start putting the packet onto the link. At that time, your packet is already on the link, so it will start traveling here towards this particular circuit here. Okay, so I'll say now when at, because you now understand this, at time 500 P1 is on the link. At time 500 I will start with the second packet, and how much time it will take? It will take 500 microseconds. Okay, so at 1000 microsecond, so I can see at 1000 microsecond, your packet P2 will be on the link. Okay, so P2 is on the link here. Okay, so at 1000 time, okay, so at 1000 time P2 will on be the link. Now it is ready to go further. So at time 1020, okay, so at time 1020, now your P2 is at your switch. Okay, so when it is at switch, so it will again take 35 and 500 microsecond here. Okay, so 35, so add 35 here, it will be 35, it will be 55 here. So at 55, P2 is still at switch, because 35 time is needed, 35 microsecond is needed for the for it to process here. Okay, so now then at now I only did 500 microsecond again, so add 500 to it. It at time 500, I'll say add 500, it will be 555. Okay, so at 555, P2 is now available at the link, available at link. Now it needs only 20 microsecond, only need 20 microsecond to end the destination here. So at time t, you are add 20 microseconds to it, it will be 1010 microsecond. So it will be at the P2 reaches at the destination. Okay, so now understand this. Now the total time that is taken from to get the one packet towards the toward to get the two packets from source to destination is actually 1575 microsecond. This is your answer. Okay, so understand this very, very carefully, that the packet P1 and P2 is going on parallelly. Okay, so how can I say this? So if you understand this one, so yeah, now understand this. At how can I explain you this one? Just wait a second. Yeah, okay, so at 500 microseconds, at 500 microsecond, your P1 will be here. Okay, so at 500 microsecond. Okay, so when it is now it will start to put the P2 onto the link. Okay, so it will reach here. The P2 is now it is going on with its own process. Because the source is free, it can begin to put the second packet onto the link, so there is no problem. So now when this particular packet reaches here, I think the time will be that I have to transmit. So this P1, when this P1 is onto the link here, the time will be, if it is available on the link, it will be 1055. Okay, so when the time is 1055, this packet second is available on this link. Okay, so when the time is 1055, it means that you've taken 500 time. Now when you transmit it at 1000, this particular packet will be available here at the link after 20 milliseconds here. So that is how you calculate it. Okay, so don't confuse it. I have written like this so that you understand it, but actually we have done this particular concept very extensively if you take a look of the packet switching part. Okay, so it's a very good question of packet switching. That is why I've included this in this particular lecture. It's a very good question. Okay, so if you do not understand it, me just contact me, or you can just copy and paste this. You will find the solution on internet as well, because I think it's a gate or net question, so that will always be there, will always be a sufficient solution that you can find on the internet. If you don't understand my solution, you can refer to other solution. Okay, still if you don't understand it, just let me know. I'll try to explain it in a different way. Okay, so other questions have also been there. So this particular question is based on the flow control part, so I think we have already discussed. So in CSM ECD part is very, very less. Okay, so there are very less questions that are based on CSM ECD. So that is why I have put CSM ECD question here also. Okay, so it's a very simple question. So if you in CSM ECD, you have to remember that the transmission time here, that the transmission time should be greater than equal to 2 into propagation time. Okay, so that is the main formula. If you remember this formula, I think every question in CSM ECD will easily be solved. Okay, so if you see here, consider a CSM ECD network that transmits data at a rate of 1000 Mbps. Okay, so they have given you a bandwidth of 10 raised to power 8 bits per second. And over 1 kilometer, they are giving you the distance here, 1 kilometer. Frame size, so they have also given you the length of the packet. So frame size is the length of the packet. No, yeah, they have given you for 520 bytes here. So they are asking about the velocity. So it's a very simple question. So you just have to fill the values here. So I think transmission time is a lower bandwidth. So you can take it as, what is your TP? TP is distance over velocity. Okay, distance over velocity. Okay, so you can find the velocity part here, because I want the velocity part here. So just, what is length over bandwidth here? So what is the length? So just what I can do is, so I can say velocity equal to 2 into D, then it will be my length, and it will be my bandwidth will be, I think, up. Okay, so if you solve it, I think you will easily get the answer here. So what is your distance here? It is 1 kilometer. They want your answer in kilometer per second. Okay, so there may be some unit you have to take here and there. Okay, either you will find the answer. Okay, so I think the answer here is 20,000 kilometers per second. Okay, so that will be the answer here because it is given in kilometer per second. So don't change this. Okay, so if it is given in 1 kilometer, take is at 1 kilometer. Don't change it to meters as well. Okay. So similarly, this question is also based on the same thing here. It is based on flow control. So you try it. If you do not got the answer, I will tell you. Okay. So again, this is one of the GET or NET question you will find it on easily on the internet. Okay. So again, I'll post these questions on there, so you can refer to these questions. Okay. So if you have any doubt, just let me know, and you start revising all the topics here. Yes.
Sir, what would be the format?